Well, welcome everybody. I'd like to introduce you to my close friend, Wali Modaqiq. We're here together at the International Crane Foundation, welcoming you to our webinar about cranes in the Middle East. First of all, I have a few announcements. The International Crane Foundation headquarters in Baraboo, Wisconsin is located within the ancestral homeland of the Ho-Chunk people. We acknowledge and honor Ho-Chunk people as caretakers of the land and water since times immemorial, and as our neighbors, friends, and vital members of our community. The International Crane Foundation is dedicated to amplifying local voices and perspectives in all the places where cranes still dance. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping notes. We are recording this webinar, and the link will be posted on our website in the coming days. If you have questions, please use the Q&A function to post your question to the presenter and our staff. We will do our best to get all your questions and answer them by the end of the presentation. I'd like to thank you for the field sponsor. This sponsor this week is the Chauncey and Marion D. McCormick Family Foundation, and this foundation has been supporting the International Crane Foundation for three generations. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams, and there's her phone number, and that's her email address, kate@savingcranes.org. Today, we're talking about a relatively new program at the International Crane Foundation, the Cranes of the Middle East. Now, this colorful map shows you some of the countries in this part of the world. Much of ICF efforts have been concentrated on the cranes of North America, the ones in East and Southern Africa, and of course, so many endangered species in East Asia. But in the Middle East, traditionally, we had Siberian cranes, migratory and also wintering there, Eurasian cranes, migratory, and demoiselle cranes. So these are the three migratory species. In the back room, in this room in our library, you can see cranes on the wall. Those are saurus cranes. Saurus cranes are also found in southern Pakistan, but not very many, and we're not talking about them today. This library that we're sitting in is dedicated to Ron Sawi. He was the co-founder, together with myself, 51 years ago, of the International Crane Foundation. And he did his doctoral studies in India, not far from Agra and the Taj Mahal, at Keoladeo National Park, where there was a population of the beautiful Siberian cranes spending the winter. There's India. We call that the central population. There's another population that went to Iran. That's the western group. And then we have the eastern population. The eastern population is doing very well. Recent counts indicate maybe over 6,000 birds. But unfortunately, we have lost the Siberian cranes in West Asia. And we're going to talk a bit about that today. There were two flocks, one that wintered in Iran and one that wintered in India. And they had to cross many different countries, and the shooting of cranes is believed to be the demise of both of these populations in recent decades. When Ron Sawi began his work in India at Keoladeo National Park, there were about 75 whooping cranes, Siberian cranes. but each winter there were fewer. He was able to go to Afghanistan to a lake where they were reported to be resting during migration. This is Lake Abyastada. And in the 1970s, the government of Afghanistan was going to protect this whole area as a nature reserve. But then warfare started in 1979 and has continued for many decades, making it not safe to work in some of these areas in Afghanistan. Ron also reported seeing not Siberian cranes, but Eurasian cranes and demoiselle cranes on sale in the market for meat in Afghanistan. The population continued to decline, and the last Siberian crane was seen in India in 2003. A very sad story. Then we have the group that went to Iran. They were not discovered until 1978, and it was in the most unusual circumstance that they were spending the winter. This is on the Caspian lowlands, Caspian Sea, and in the background to the south are the Alborz Mountains. On the other side is the huge city of Tehran. But out here in the coastal wetlands, the hunting of waterfowl is rampant, hunting with guns, but in one area it's silent because, oh, there we go. As you can see on the left, huge concentrations of ducks are attracted to rice fields that are surrounded by little patches of forest in which hunters have devised various ways of capturing these birds alive and then killing them for the market. So if you want to catch your ducks, you want to have many in this central area. It's called a damga. And on the right, here's one of the hunters chasing his little flock of domestic ducks, which have not had breakfast. They're hungry, go through a channel leading to the edge of this compound where so many birds are concentrated. Here he goes. He's herding his ducks. These are mallards. They're domestic mallards, so, but they can fly. And they're very hungry. And he will chase them out to the end of this little channel and into a box where he can catch them very easily. And he picks one duck up at a time. And when wild ducks fly over, he throws a duck in the air and they will join the wild ducks and fly around and land on a little pond in the forest where there are traps, and they drop the net and can catch the wild ducks. So the farmers are very proud of their cultural tradition of capturing waterfowl in this way. And in the nearby town of Ferry Dunkanar, you can see many ducks on sale in the market. Well, in the central area where the birds are attracted, they found the Siberian cranes. The reason they had not been observed is because the duck trappers did not want bird watchers in this area because they might frighten the waterfowl away. So when they were discovered in 1978, there were about 12 birds, and each year they would bring their young. Two or three young every winter. Satellite radios were placed on one of these several of these birds, and we were able to trace their migration route to their breeding grounds in Russia. But unfortunately, after the Soviet Union fell apart in 1990, there was widespread hunting throughout the migration route. Well, this is the Eurasian crane. The Eurasian cranes winter in India and they migrate across the Hindu Kush Mountains of Afghanistan and Pakistan. They also migrate down into Iran and down the east coast of the Mediterranean Sea to Ethiopia. So there are many migration routes of the Eurasian cranes in the Middle East. Likewise, Amazel cranes, which breed on the Russian steppes and Kazakhstan area, they come down over the mountains into India, and two other groups, one from the Black Sea area go to Chad, and the other group goes down into the Sudan and Eritrea and Ethiopia. Well, our story starts with keeping cranes in captivity. We start at the Crane Foundation by breeding very, very rare cranes in captivity as a conservation measure to establish a species bank of these rare birds in captivity. But for hundreds of years, in certain areas of Pakistan, cranes have been kept in captivity. And it's quite an art how they catch them, how they maintain them, and how they breed them. For example, this is in a palace of the governor, and he has his favorite pair of Eurasian cranes. They can put them in these cages, take them out to the countryside for a stroll, and the birds are very, very tame and easily managed. So they're sort of part of the family. And many of them breed in captivity, and they take great care of their cranes, and the cranes know the people. And there's this wonderful relationship between the cranes and the local people. Here's a flock of demoiselle cranes. They have their wing feathers clipped, but they've wandered out from the village into the fields to feed. And in the evening, they'll come back. Each pair knows where they belong, and they'll go to their home, and they'll shut the gate, and the birds are safe during the night. They have a beautiful relationship with these birds and vice versa. And often you can see here's a pair with the juvenile demoiselle crane. It's been estimated by our colleague Ahmed Khan that there may be as many as 15,000 Eurasian cranes and demoiselle cranes in captivity in Pakistan. And this is how they catch the wild cranes to get them started in captivity. As well as breeding them in captivity, they capture from the wild. These guys, a whole bunch of men, gather together beside one of the rivers that's coming out of the mountains. And this is in the springtime when the Eurasian cranes and the demoiselle cranes are migrating from India to their breeding grounds in the north. So here's a pair of demoiselle cranes, the four pairs of demoiselles. They got the members of the pair side by side. The cranes are very happy to be close to their mate. And they'll feed them and water them in these little cages. And the way they capture the wild cranes is to attract the wild flocks to fly low over the river. And they have these long ropes with a big weight on the end, and they'll toss the rope up into the flock of cranes, and it will tangle with the wing. To get the wild cranes to come close, they put the captive cranes out near the river, and they'll separate the male from the female by just moving their cages apart. They'll get upset and start calling to one another, and that attracts the wild cranes to come down. The Pakistani crane catcher is hidden in this little grassy mound. And as the cranes fly low over the caged birds, he'll toss up his cord into them and hopefully catch one. They go out there for about a month during the migration. And every time they catch a crane, of course, it's a celebration. Well, we have wonderful colleagues in Pakistan who have been working on the conservation of cranes for many, many decades, actually. This is Ashik Ahmed Khan on the right with the World Wildlife Fund. And Ahmed Khan, who's now at the University of Maryland, and Mumtaz Malik from the government. So the private organizations like WWF and ICF and the government have been in close contact for many years. They built a crane conservation center where you can learn about cranes along the road. And many years ago, I had the opportunity to travel with my Afghan or Pakistani colleagues to a crane festival in the mountains. Now, these people who keep cranes like to get together, and they have this festival to talk about cranes. Maybe they exchange birds. And this is what happens. They carry the cranes in these crates and they put a covering over them so the birds are not disturbed. Some of them were on the back of a camel. Others were in ox carts. Others were in motor vehicles, but they all converged on this town. Many people were carrying their firearms with them because this is in a border area near Afghanistan. There are always security concerns. And Ashiq Ahmed Khan is giving a lecture to the gentlemen that have brought their cranes. And he's talking about the importance of conservation, that we shouldn't shoot cranes. We can trap some cranes, maintain this tradition, but not shoot them. I was there with big posters, and I wanted to give them as prizes, one to the person with the oldest Eurasian crane in captivity and one to the demoiselle. So I'd say, put up your hand if you have a crane more than 10 years old, 20 years old, 30 years old. The winner of the Eurasian crane contest was 53 years old. And the winner of the demoiselle crane was 72 years old. And this tiny little man came up to tell me about his crane. And he said, this crane has been with us for many generations. And it became blind when it was in its 60s. But she knows her way around our yard. She knows where to drink and to feed and to rest. And she's like a member of our family. And he said, I love this crane even more than my wife. So it was a very special bird to him. So we had lots of stories about the cranes. And at night they had the calling contest. The people that owned cranes would bring them to this square, and they would separate the male from the female and walk around, and the cranes are upset because they're separated from their mate, and they're calling and calling and calling. And it was sort of a competition to determine who has the most consistent and the loudest calls. And these are the judges taking down information about each pair of cranes. And it was about 1 o'clock in the morning by the time the contest was over, and the first prize were given to the loudest demoiselle crane and the loudest Eurasian crane. I'm going to turn the program over now to Wali Modaqiq, who's with me here today. He's from Afghanistan, but now living in Baraboo, Wisconsin. And he's going to tell you what's happening in recent decades.
Hi to everyone. Actually, the shooting of cranes is a very critical challenge in the Middle East. It's also not only no shooting, it's capturing going on in almost all the in the Middle East countries. And also, you know, people are keeping the cranes so far as a pet. And also there's, you know, the hunters are selling cranes in the market too. So this is me. So when I started in 1997, I started my career with the studying of cranes in Lake Abistada, and that's in Afghanistan. And then me in 2004, because the crane hunting was expanded to the other provinces in this picture in the Middle East from the Parwan province. And again, it's me in 2024, now in Baraboo. So you can see some of our field work. So the right picture in the right side is Dashtinawar, which is a critical place for the migratory birds, for its breeding area and habitat for the flamingos. And also it's a stopover place for the cranes. And also in the right side is a tent, our tent in Abi Stada. So, you know, you might heard lots of negative things about Afghanistan, but Afghanistan got a very good landscape as well. You can see the picture. This is the Afghanistan's first national park called Bandi Amir National Park. The people over there is they're very traditional people, so they have very simple life and not very educated. But in my opinion, the education and awareness is very important in Afghanistan, particularly as most of the Middle East countries are Muslim countries. So we are trying to involve the mullahs, imams, and mosques in the awareness raising and also environmental education and the conservation. Actually, we practiced that some years ago in Afghanistan. It went very well, so we got a very positive result of that activity to involve mullahs and religious in Islam. So Islam says very clearly, you know, it's asking all Muslims, even all people, to pay attention for the conservation of the nature. Of course, you know, hunting is allowed in Islam, but it's not like unlimited kind of hunting. So there are, you know, several conditions for the hunters to follow. So I think if we and all our colleagues in the Middle East, if they ask and involve mullahs and imams and awareness raising and also in education, I think it's it will work very well, and we can protect the cranes over there. So in 2023, I moved my family to the United States because of the regime change. So I would like to thank the International Crane Foundation, particularly Dr. George Archibald. They helped me and my family. We moved here, so we are living in Baraboo now. We are living in freedom, and my kids have access to the education. I'm so happy with that. And also, I would like to thank Conservation X Lab, an NGO based in Washington, and also a law firm in New York. They helped us for getting the visas and process our cases. So I'm really thankful to them. And also Dr. Elena Ilyashenko, she's the administrator of the Russian Crane Working Group. She is a very professional researcher. She did a lot. This is a map she produced that's based on the tracking of cranes in the Middle East. We can see, you know, the cranes are crossing all, you know, so many countries. So this is the list of the countries in the Middle East. So it's the Middle East is a quite challenging region nowadays, but we believe that crane can unite us in that region. And also the International Crane Foundation established the Middle East Crane Conservation Group 2 years ago. I'm voluntarily coordinating that group with the help of Dr. Elena Ilyashenko and Dr. George Archibald and all our colleagues here in the ICF and also in the region. You know, the skies in the Middle East were you know, it was beauty because of the flying of the cranes. You can see that in this picture. But unfortunately, we lost the Siberian cranes in the central flyway. And also, you can see the shooting of cranes in Lebanon just this year in March 2024. And also in Saudi Arabia, people are making artificial wetlands to attack the cranes for shooting. So they're just killing the cranes. And also, this is a picture from Pakistan this year. The good thing is that we have a very good team, but it's a small team of female and male. So young people, they are looking to study cranes in Pakistan. Actually, ICF supported one project which is going on to do the situational analysis of the cranes in Pakistan. And also, we are trying to work with those two ladies to help them to study cranes in Punjab province of Pakistan. I would like to hand over back to George to continue the presentation.
Thank you very much, Wally. As you can see, we are hopeful that peace will come to the Middle East, though things are having their ups and downs. We're optimistic. Wally is safely here. He speaks many languages. He understands the values of the people in the Middle East. And upon this basis, with the help of our Russian colleagues who are doing radio tracking of the cranes, finding out where their signal stops, which would indicate where they're being killed. So a lot of good things are happening. And I dream that someday we can reestablish the flocks of migratory Siberian cranes to India and to Iran, much as has happened in the United States with our whooping crane and sandhill crane. Here in the States, we have the most abundant crane in the world, the sandhill, and the rarest, the whooping crane. And ICF developed techniques back in the 1980s to use costumed people to raise whooping cranes. And our people at Friends at Operation Migration, dressed in a crane costume, led these cranes south from Wisconsin to Florida to start a new population. This had a big impact on our Russian colleagues. So they have established a captive breeding center at the Oka Nature Reserve, not far from Moscow. They have a flourishing population of Siberian cranes that produce many eggs and juveniles every year. So there's an opportunity to take birds from captivity and put them back into the wild, as we have done with the whooping crane. The Russians and colleagues from Italy have done research on flying with cranes using ultralight aircraft and even hang gliders. And whereas we have the sandhill crane, which is very helpful in developing techniques to help the whooping crane, over in Asia, they have the beautiful Eurasian crane. And Eurasian cranes continue to come to India along a route that was used by the Siberian cranes. Those dark arrows and the yellow arrow indicate the migration route of the Siberian crane up until 2003. So someday maybe we can apply the techniques developed in the United States using ultralight led birds in Russia and then attaching them to the migratory cranes that fly over the mountains to India. But all of this will be predicated on Wally's work with our support in the Middle East. We now have this nice program started in Pakistan, I recently visited Saudi Arabia and their government's committed to crane conservation. And ICF is supporting a program in Turkey where there are also the demoiselle crane. There's only one pair left in the wild, and they have a very rare subspecies of the Eurasian crane in the mountains. So we have this great group of countries, 30 of them. Some are in Africa where the cranes go in the winter, of course. We have this great group of colleagues in Russia that we keep in close touch with. And we're developing a stronger and stronger group in the Middle East. And I love this quote from Margaret Mead. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed individuals can change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that ever has. And although we're small, we now have the internet for communication, Zoom meetings, and so on, tools that we never had before that can be very useful in our work. If you would like to support our work in the Middle East, you can contact this website of the Crane Foundation and indicate if you're sending in a check that you'd like it applied to the Middle East Crane Conservation Group. We're going to need many resources in the future to bring a success. I'd like to introduce you now to my assistant, Karen Becker, who is going to, she's been looking at questions that come in, and then we will try to answer the questions.
Hi, everybody. I have a question about what's happening with the populations of the cranes in the Middle East. Are they rising or falling, and what are the reasons? And how does that compare to other countries? For example, the Eurasian cranes in the Middle East as compared to Europe.
Unfortunately, we don't have good numbers about the Eurasian crane. We know that they are being hunted at a very high rate in Pakistan and Afghanistan. But we do have information from Elena Ilyashenko about the demoiselle cranes. Northwest of the Caspian Sea, in an area of Russia called Kalmykia, it's a steppe area. There are demoiselle cranes. There used to be approximately 30,000 birds in this North Caspian area. And they migrate along a very narrow route through the mountains to the south, the Caucasus Mountains, where they can be counted. That's how they estimate that there were 30,000. But they've noticed a huge decline in this population of demoiselle cranes. And a recent estimate was that there may be as few as 1,500 birds left in the population. They migrate along the west of the Caspian Sea near the mountains and south across Azerbaijan, Iran, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, onto winter in Sudan, Eritrea, and South Sudan. But we have much to learn. We don't know how extensive the hunting is. We know that there's hunting in Saudi Arabia, and the Saudi Arabian government is very much aware of this problem and are taking action to arrest people that are killing cranes. In Europe, the Eurasian crane has increased, and there may be as many as 300,000 birds or more. There's an amazing recovery, but we had a very big setback last winter in Hungary. There's a staging area in Hungary where several hundred thousand cranes gather, and 20,000 to 30,000 birds died from avian flu. The same thing happened in the Hula Valley of northern Israel 2 years ago when 8,000 birds died from avian flu. So that's another threat to the cranes, over concentration of birds at certain areas.
Ahmed Khan, from our colleague that's originally from Pakistan, has sent me a note that he estimates on the hunting of cranes that at least 10% of the population migrating through the country are hunted, are killed by shooting in Pakistan. And okay. I have another question. Is there an acceptance of women doing conservation work in the Middle East? And what roles can they fulfill?
As per my knowledge, the women are not involved in the hunting, and also they are not very active in conservation, but they have a critical role, to talk the crane's importance and also to raise their kids to be like a friend with the nature. So if we involve the women in the conservation, it will help to have less people, doing hunting. But I have no any idea like a practical work of women in general in conservation. But we do have some young students in most of the countries that are doing conservation activities, but that's from the education sector. But if we involve more women in the conservation in general, I think it will be very good. But I have no like a real example to give it here.
Okay, thanks, Wally.
I have an example in Iran. There's a wonderful lady, Ellen Tavakoli from Finland, who's become Iranian. And she spent many years helping the Siberian cranes. And Lisa Porlak, a younger Iranian conservation, has been very, very active in helping that program. So I think in Iran, there are quite a few women involved in conservation. And I was amazed at the recent meeting I attended in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. It was about the conservation of birds. And a lot of the government representatives from the various Middle Eastern countries were ladies and very passionate about both the challenges. So things are changing, and we're very optimistic, and we're delighted that we are supporting a lady professor in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, who's leading this study about Eurasian cranes in Pakistan.
And Ahmed also notes that there are many leading women in conservation in Pakistan.
Right.
So there's a question about the cranes in the Middle East. Are they breeding there, or are they just wintering there or migrating through?
Well,
and how does the loss of natural habitats affect them?
Yeah, Turkey was a major breeding area for demoiselle cranes, and they're very much woven into the cultural fabric of that country. Unfortunately, we only know of one pair that survived to breed in Turkey. But this year, Freddie Akarsu and Elena Ilyashenko and her husband, Valentin Ilyashenko, will be looking in other areas. It could be in some remote areas there are more demoiselle cranes. The Eurasian crane also breeds in the Caucasus area. There may be 300 or 400 birds. It's a distinct subspecies called the Caucasian crane. They breed very high up in the mountains, and they have no red comb on their head. It's black, and they're a little bit bigger than other Eurasian cranes. So there's an effort in Georgia, Armenia, and Turkey, and on the conservation of those cranes. But cranes don't breed in the other countries in the Middle East. They're mainly migratory, just passing through the countries in the spring and in the fall, or they're wintering there. Large numbers of Eurasian cranes are wintering in Iran and possibly in some areas of Pakistan, and possibly one spot in Saudi Arabia. But mainly they're birds of passage through the Middle East. So when you see these large flocks coming through a mountain pass, they spread out over an enormous range on both their wintering areas and their breeding areas, but they're concentrated along these migratory pathways and very easy to shoot, especially with automatic weapons as is being done today. Wally, maybe you can mention about the proliferation of firearms.
Thank you so much. You know, when Afghanistan was invaded by Russians, by the former Soviet Union, despite you know, trying the country's economy and also social structure and other things, you know, the access to the weapons were everywhere and all over the country. So people had weapons like, you know, 5 to 10 automatic machine guns in their houses. It makes the situation very worse. You know, everyone was shooting everything. You know, that was a big problem, but unfortunately, still it continues. And also, it happened in some of the province in Pakistan as well, because, you know, we are bordering with Pakistan, so the weapons were everywhere. So it makes the situation for cranes and for all birds very difficult. Now we have, you know, increase in hunting in our region.
Okay. And we have a message from Hadis, our colleague in Ethiopia. He wants to know, is there any initiative or possibility to include the African countries like Ethiopia, Sudan, Eritrea, and Chad to this Middle Eastern group to share information on the wintering habitat populations?
Of course, Karen, there is a possibility. Okay. Mentioned, so the cranes in the Middle East, they're migratory birds. It means, you know, they're crossing most of the Middle East countries, but it's possible to include, you know, some other countries from Africa where the cranes are wintering there. And also, it's very important, you know, if we don't have those countries in our network, in our group, I think it will be very difficult to have, you know, good result of our initiative.
And I'm thrilled that you're listening, Hadis, to this webinar. And I want to tell everybody that there's something very special about Ethiopia for birds. In Ethiopia, it's a taboo to kill birds, to hurt birds. And the cranes are very safe when they get to Ethiopia. And thousands of Eurasian cranes are wintering in the Rift Valley of Ethiopia. And up in northwestern Ethiopia, tens of thousands of Dumuzel cranes used to be seen there in the winter coming in from the Sudan. So we welcome, of course, in our very informal Middle East crane conservation group, our wonderful colleagues from the African countries, of course.
Good. Is there evidence of climate change impacting the cranes in the Middle East?
Are there migration?
Is the Aral Sea dried up?
The Aral Sea was heavily tapped during the Soviet Union time to produce cotton in that part of the Soviet Union. And cotton requires a great deal of water. But apparently after the Soviet Union fell apart, the people in Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan, which has the source of the river that goes to the Aral Sea, the Amudaria River, They wanted to grow cereals like grain and wheat and so on, and they require much less water. So I've heard reports that the Aral Sea has risen to some extent. I don't think it's to the extent it was previously. Wally, you know more about that, maybe.
Yeah, thank you so much. Just to add that, you know, we can see lots of the negative impact of the climate change in Afghanistan, particularly on Lake Abisada and that in our work, because I remember, you know, many times, you know, the Abisada Lake was completely dry, because that was a very important stopover for the cranes. And also I heard that, you know, I saw a picture of the lake in Pakistan as well, the Wasta Lake. It's dry because of the drought. You know, it's now we have drought like after every 3-4 years we experience severe drought in the Central Asian countries. So definitely it affects the cranes. You know, when there's you know, they stop over, so the water is very important for them. So if there is no water, so they cannot stop in those locations. So yeah, definitely climate change affects the cranes in the migratory birds in general.
Okay. If we have cultures where hunting is a very traditional part of their cultures, like in many Middle East countries, what are some practical ways that we can reduce or educate about changing those behaviors?
You know, as I mentioned before, as we know, the hunting is like culture on most of the Middle East countries. But as I mentioned before, so most of those countries are followers of the Islam. But in Islam, it's very clear. It says very, you know, very much, you know, to look after the nature, the wildlife. So if we involved, I think, the mullahs and imams and mosques in the conservation activity, I think that's a good approach to change the behavior of the people. And also, you know, to encourage those people, you know, not just, you know, kill the birds. So if they follow the rules, which is very clearly mentioned in Islam, I'm sure, you know, there will be a lot of reduction on hunting of the birds and wildlife in the Middle East countries.
In addition, now we have a way to communicate to the masses through electronic communication. And a lot of the hunting incidents we knew about because people were very proud of killing these birds and they made videos and put them on the internet. Well, unfortunately, that backfired in Saudi Arabia because they were arrested and put in jail because it's illegal to shoot cranes. And the same thing in Pakistan. There's a law that prohibits the shooting of cranes. The same thing in Lebanon, but the cranes are being killed. So enforcing the law is important. So we need more police action at critical sites to protect the birds. But through the social media, I think if we handle it properly, we can get a public outcry against this activity because it's a very small number of people that are doing it when you look at the huge populations in those countries. Would you agree with me, Wally? Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And one last question, is the crane trade an issue as is separate from shooting of cranes in the Middle East? In other words, are they being captured and sold? Is that affecting the populations?
Yeah, Ahmed Khan, maybe you can post in a comment about that. But I know that they're being captured live and sold live in Pakistan. Now, maybe some of those are sold and they're kept as pets, but maybe they keep them alive and then kill them and hide them under dead chickens on trucks going into cities and then sold as meat. We have evidence that that's happening as well. So there's a lot of criminal activity going on. And if we can have laws enforced, things will be better.
Okay. That was my last question to you guys.
Yeah. I can talk a little bit about the Middle East Crane Conservation Group. We are trying to develop a list of people from each country who would like to receive information and who can communicate with us about what's happening in their country. So if anybody in the listening audience is aware of people that you know that might be interested in becoming involved in the issues in the Middle East, or that might be interested in contributing support for our efforts, please let us know. We'd love to hear from you. We're very inclusive, and this is the ultimate international group of diversity. We're excited about it, but you can become involved.